The year is 1863. A young American nation stands divided in pitched conflict between northern and southern states. Amidst the turmoil, a small Pennsylvania town, then known as Spring Forge, is about to embark on a journey of growth and innovation. On a brisk November morning, handbills are distributed throughout the countryside, announcing the sale of the Jacob Howard paper mill. For sale is a stone paper mill with one 56-inch paper machine, four tenant houses, and 101 acres of land. An entrepreneurial young man by the name of Philip Henry Glatfelter is working at the Lauchs Hoffman & Company paper mill in nearby Maryland when Mr. Lauchs informs Philip of an investment opportunity that will forever change his life. On December 23, 1863, just a few weeks after President Abraham Lincoln passes through Spring Forge on his way to deliver his historic Gettysburg Address, Philip Glatfelter arrives to purchase the Howard paper mill for the sum of $14,000. An astute businessman, Philip spends the next 7 months procuring a sufficient supply of white linen rags whose fibers are used to make paper so that he can operate without interruption. At the time of the Civil War, rags are very expensive and in short supply, a combination that pushes the Howard mill into insolvency. But Philip's careful planning yields a very different result when on July 2nd, 1864, he successfully opens his doors for business, producing 1,500 pounds of newsprint per day. Another shining moment comes shortly thereafter when Philip and his wife Amanda become proud parents of their first child, William Lincoln Glatfelter. William will share his name with President Lincoln, whose tragic assassination occurred just 13 days prior to William's birth. Philip begins the first of many mill expansions as he more than doubles production from 1,500 to 4,000 pounds of newsprint per day. But this expansion is not without its supply challenges, one of them being location, since the nearest railroad is miles away in the town of York. At the time, raw materials and finished product are hauled to and from the railroad via horse-drawn wagons. Recognizing the need for increased efficiency, Philip set the wheels in motion for a railroad to soon pass through Spring Forge. Fortunately, construction of the railroad commences by the time the company embarks on its second expansion. Philip's investment of the railroad would be repaid many times over throughout the years. Investing $200,000, Philip moves his papermaking operation from the old iron forge Mr. Howard had converted to a newly constructed facility, complete with a state-of-the-art paper machine. The new buildings were located a few hundred yards from the old forge and increased total production to 10,000 pounds a day, a sevenfold increase in capacity in the company's first 10 years of operation. Philip Glatfelter finds himself in good company in the 1870s, a decade when Alexander Graham Bell invents the telephone and starts the Bell Telephone Company. Thomas Edison follows with the invention of the light bulb, an innovation Philip quickly capitalizes on to enhance his community and the millwork environment. Philip knows that being successful means more than generating a profit. While he takes great pride in paying his employees well and providing customers with a reliable quality product, Philip is also passionate about improving the quality of life for the surrounding community. This sense of obligation leads him to finance the cost of a new brick schoolhouse, giving a formal education to the growing number of Spring Forge children. Within the year, Philip also provides the financing to build and furnish St. Paul's Lutheran Church so that the townspeople have a proper place to worship. Years later, Philip again finances a complete rebuilding of this church to accommodate a much larger congregation. This church still serves the townspeople today. Several years later, satisfied with the progress of his community, Philip sets his sights on becoming an industry leader. By 1880, Philip completes the company's third and most aggressive expansion to date, installing the world's largest paper machine, a 100-inch Fourdrinier paper machine that still operates today as PM No. 5. Philip's aggressive expansion in papermaking capacity is matched by an equally bold investment in new, state-of-the-art fiber technology that eliminates the dependency on rags for making paper. Realizing that white linen rags would continue to be in short supply, Philip capitalizes on a new technology that uses caustic soda to separate cellulose wood fibers. Convinced that wood is a more sustainable fiber source, Philip invests substantial funds to convert the entire mill to being a consumer of renewable wood pulp. Achieving continued success as a world-class supplier, Philip invests in yet another paper machine, expanding the mill's production to 30,000 pounds per day. Philip's vision of building a world-class company firmly rooted in the community is paying dividends to the residents of Spring Forge, now known as Spring Grove. Thanks to the Glatfelter Mill, houses are furnished with running water from a reservoir, and the town is illuminated by electric lights using cost-effective electricity generated by the mill, all just a few short years after the light bulb is invented. Spring Grove is quickly becoming a model community, but the town still lacked a fire department. So the Spring Grove Fire Company, Friendship Hose Company No. 1, is established, and Philip's son William is elected president, a role he proudly serves until his passing in 1930. In support of the new fire company, Philip commissions the first fire engine house to be built. Recognizing Philip's proven eye for good business and commitment to community growth, a small group of businessmen ask for his help in leading their struggling company. Seeing the potential for success, Philip purchases the business and assumes the role of president for the York Manufacturing Company. Under his leadership, he refocuses the company to produce ice and refrigeration machines, growing sales from $40,000 a year to $1.5 million, and employing a skilled workforce of more than 1,000, the largest of any industry in York at the time. Known today as York International, this industry leader provides jobs to over 23,000 men and women around the world. It is at this time in the mid-1880s that Philip's son William completes his formal education and begins an apprenticeship at the Glatfelter Mill. Being a strong supporter of education, Philip sends William to the Eastman Business School in New York and later Gettysburg College in Pennsylvania to prepare for management in the paper company. Loyal to his son's alma mater, Philip serves on the Board of Trustees at Gettysburg College from 1888 until his passing in 1907, and contributes a substantial portion of the funds needed to construct the massive on-campus school building known as Glatfelter Hall. This building will play a vital role in educating several generations of college students, as well as many of today's leaders. Shortly after graduation, William marries Catherine Rebecca Hollinger and resides in his Victorian childhood home, while Philip builds a new house for himself, his wife, and the rest of the family. To this day, the home still graces Main Street in downtown Spring Grove as a fine example of Victorian architecture. Not long after the family settle into their homes, Philip celebrates becoming a grandfather. Catherine delivers Philip H. Glatfelter II. Philip's namesake and future company heir. The company also has cause for celebration. It's the 25th anniversary, and the mill has developed into one of the most modern and efficient in the industry, with production exceeding 100,000 pounds of paper per day. With William by his side, Philip wastes no time in plotting a new course that will position the company as the preferred supplier of high-quality specialty papers. Philip's strategy refocuses the mill's assets from making paper for newsprint to making fine printing and writing papers for books, envelopes, lithography, and business forms. Philip was well positioned to target book and related printing and writing markets, thanks to the long-term relationships he forged years earlier. In the 1870s, Philip worked closely with industry greats like Henry Lindenmeyer, Alling and Corey, and the Eagle Mill. In the 1880s, he aligned with Buckley Dunton, Currier, and J.E. Lind, and by the 1890s, he had fostered strong ties with Bradner Smith, Carpenter, and Plymouth. With strong distribution channels in place, Glatfelter marks its first sale of cream book paper in 1890. Thanks to the hard work of the emerging merchant community, Glatfelter quickly dominates the book market and positions the company for long-term success. Envelope and converting papers are also an important part of the mix. In fact, Glatfelter sells its first envelope paper in 1892. In 1895, William contributes to the sustainability of the company, the industry, and the environment with a technological breakthrough in pulp production by building the first successfully operated facility for processing both hardwood and softwood pulps. Until this time, only hardwoods could be processed to make paper. Softwoods, such as pine, were full of sap and nearly impossible to process. William's breakthrough enables abundant pines and other softwoods to be used to make paper. Environmentally, this helps ease the strain put on hardwoods by lumber companies and paper mills. It also provides for the blending of hard and softwood fibers for improved strength and printability, a critical component to all fine printing and writing papers. Like his father, William is very active in the community, serving as president of the school board. With the support of his father, William funds the construction of a new public school building. This modern school will serve the growing community and continues to do so to this day. Thanks to the work ethic, ingenuity, leadership, and community spirit of Philip and William Glatfelter, the company and the town of Spring Grove find themselves positioned for solid growth well into the 20th century. After an uncertain economic decade, the late 1890s gave way to a spirit of unbridled optimism and innovation that brightened the dawn of the 20th century. Symbolized by the 1900 World's Fair in Paris, this spirit came alive in the new century's early years as the inspiration and hard work of inventors and visionaries gave rise to modern marvels. The airplane, the radio, Henry Ford's Model T, the phonograph, the skyscraper, and more. It was a good time to be an innovator, a leader, an entrepreneur, with vision and the work ethic to back it up. And Philip Glatfelter II, the son of William Glatfelter, was just that person. For him, the world was full of exciting possibilities, and he looked forward to making his mark on the future. Philip Glatfelter II, or Phil as his friends called him, was developing into a young man, working various small jobs around the paper mill, and observing those who were masters at the craft. Following Phil's graduation from high school, his father William sent him to the prestigious Hill School in Pennsylvania, where he began to develop and refine his leadership skills in both academics and sports. Upon graduation, Phil took employment at the York Manufacturing Company as a student mechanic before transitioning to the paper company as assistant treasurer. It was the policy of Phil's father and grandfather to ensure that any Glatfelter who aspired to run the company would earn their way to the top through hard work in the classroom and years of service on the shop floor. The paper mill was also growing up. In 1906, the operation was officially incorporated as the P.H. Glatfelter Company with capital of $1 million. Unfortunately, this would prove to be the founder's final contribution to his beloved paper mill. On July 4, 1907, Philip I passed away at the age of 70. Philip devoted his life to his community as well as his paper mill, working to improve educational and commercial opportunities for the people of Spring Grove. Under his 43 years of leadership, the mill grew from 1,500 pounds of paper produced per day to more than 100,000 pounds, providing employment for over 325 highly skilled employees. While assuming the helm of the company might have seemed daunting, William Glatfelter was ready to answer the call, having served 20 years under his father's leadership. Respected both in the community and by his employees, William would steer the growing paper company through some of the greatest challenges facing the country. During his presidency, the company saw substantial expansion, with output doubled to 100 tons per day and the addition of some of the most advanced papermaking machinery at the time. Shortly after the turn of the century, William became a proud grandfather as his son Phil II and wife Cassandra gave birth to their first baby boy, Philip III, soon followed by another son, William II. Unfortunately, Phil was not able to enjoy much time with his new family as the United States had entered into the First World War. As lieutenant in the Officers Reserve Corps, Phil sailed for France, where he was stationed for 14 months, earning the rank of captain in the 3rd Heavy Mobile Repair Unit. His time leading the unit would prove invaluable, as it allowed him to refine the skills he would need to modernize the paper mill through the 1920s and 30s. In preparation for the expansion that occurred following the war, William officially incorporated the Glatfelter Pulpwood Company to ensure an ample and consistent supply of wood pulp. With this incorporation, William had the distinction of appointing one of the country's first industrial foresters to help educate farmers in the practice of sustainable forestry. This education program was so successful that 2 decades later, more than 700 farms surrounding Spring Grove had managed woodlands, generating enough revenue that allowed many farmers to put their children through college. With the Pulpwood Company and forestry education program in place, and Phil's return from the war, the Glatfelters were ready to push the company full steam ahead into the roaring 20s. William and Phil focused their expansion efforts on the growing book market, one they had consistently served since 1890. To meet the growing demand for quality book paper, the mill expanded an additional 85,000 square feet and built the largest machine dedicated to the production of book paper at the time, PM No. 2. During construction, Glatfelter engineers designed the foredrenier section so that the wire could be replaced without dismantling the entire foredrenier. This significantly reduced maintenance, improved productivity, and provided a technological breakthrough for the entire industry, solidifying Glatfelter's reputation for innovation. To commemorate the completion of this expansion in 1923, in what would become a long-standing annual tradition that remains intact today, Glatfelter hosted its first New York paper merchant mill tour and education program. Representatives from Lindenmeyer, Buckley Dunton, Alling and Corey, and many more were brought to Spring Grove via a dedicated train and were provided boarding at the new Glatfelter estate. Glatfelter was also a leader in the area of employee communications. In 1920, the company issued the first Barker, a monthly employee magazine designed to enhance employee communications, a good 20 years before most companies adopted this practice. Glatfelter used the Barker as a rallying medium to improve the quality of life through topics such as safety, fire prevention, and cleanliness, as well as extracurricular activities. Viewing an accident-free workplace as a key component to the quality of life for their employees, Glatfelter established an internal safety organization, which was sponsored by the Pennsylvania State Department of Safety. With 100% employee participation, Phil was soon recognized for this success and elected the first president of the National Safety Council in York, Pennsylvania. Family matters were also proceeding nicely. During the 1920s, Phil took great pride in the birth of his daughter Elizabeth and sons Theodore and George Glatfelter I. Unfortunately, the country was about to experience the worst stock market crash in history, pushing the entire U.S. economy into a 10-year-long Great Depression. Furthermore, Phil II would not have his father's guidance to help navigate these turbulent times, as William Glatfelter unexpectedly passed away on Easter Sunday, 1930. These were clearly not ordinary times, but fortunately, Philip was not an ordinary man. He was the product of a hard-working, well-educated family, a war veteran, and a man dedicated to the people he served and led. Rather than panic or become intimidated by the trying economic times, Philip planned decisively for the future and boldly invested $2 million in the company's most aggressive expansion to date, an expansion that would span the 10-year period of the Great Depression. The result was a complete retooling of both the pulp and paper mill, and the construction of a new water dam and reservoir called Lake Lehman. Crowning the expansion efforts was the installation of the company's largest paper machine at the time, PM No. 1. Like most businesses during the Depression, the paper mill did not operate at full capacity. However, Phil made a promise to do his best to give available work to every employee, especially those with families, so that everyone could continue to have an income. Phil kept his promise and never laid anyone off during the Great Depression, a time when unemployment averaged nearly 20%. Recognizing the economic, environmental, and social devastation caused by the Dust Bowl during the 30s, Phil made the decision to help promote the U.S. government's newly formed Soil Conservation Program, which focused on modern soil conservation practices to manage erosion. At the time, the government was having great difficulty convincing farmers to implement newly developed conservation practices. To ensure the success of this program, Phil had the keen insight to hire a young man who knew the farmers and spoke their Pennsylvania Dutch language. Phil's bet paid off. By the third year, the conservation program was so successful, the government had to hire additional full-time staff to manage the demand. As the Depression gradually ended, the company celebrated the completion of its massive mill-wide upgrade and expansion, as well as its historic 75th anniversary in 1939. During a special anniversary event, Phil prepared a speech that praised the drive and determination that had brought the company so far and called for even more resilience in the years ahead. He said, "Our company looks forward because a productive enterprise must be constantly alive to the process of change going on in all industry." It was a natural reaction to keep moving forward because Phil was not one to stand idle. Like his father and grandfather, he had given much of himself to his company, his community, and his country. Unfortunately, he would have to give much more as the world prepared to enter the Second World War. Phil watched as all four of his sons and 126 of his extended family of mill employees left to serve their country. Having served in the First World War himself, Phil knew of the hardships all his young men would face. While he could not fight alongside them, he was determined to do everything possible to support them. He encouraged all Glatfelter employees to participate in the War Bond Savings Program so that employees in the military would have a nest egg waiting for them upon their return. He sent issues of the Barker, along with money, so that all of his men would get a much-needed taste of home to lift their spirits and boost morale. And he guaranteed that every employee serving in the military would have a position upon their return, along with special consideration for promotions. For his support and helping veterans integrate back into civilian life, Phil and his paper company received the Certificate of Commendation from the American Legion, only the second company in Pennsylvania to receive this award. He also received a special citation from the U.S. Treasury Department for exceeding quota in all 8 savings bond drives and earned the distinct honor to fly the Minuteman flag. The war brought with it many challenges to operating the paper company, as raw materials became expensive and hard to find, given that most materials were diverted to the war effort. Manpower was also in short supply, and with so many men in the military, women played a key role in the manufacturing workforce. Glatfelter was fortunate to have employed a group of hardworking women who were willing and able to fill the shoes of their husbands and relatives serving their country. These dedicated women worked a variety of jobs at all levels within the company. Phil praised their effort, stating, "We could hardly keep operating without them." Even with wartime disruptions, the company never stopped emphasizing safety, winning safety awards from the National Safety Council, most notably for having worked over 1 million man-hours with only 1 lost time accident. The company also filmed and produced Plan for Safety, the paper industry's first employee safety education movie, which was quickly adopted by the National Safety Council as an essential safety training tool. As the 1940s transitioned from World War II to the post-war boom years, Phil would again have the pleasure of working alongside his sons as they returned from the military. Not long thereafter, Phil would celebrate the birth of a special individual, a new generation, his grandson, George Glatfelter II. As Glatfelter crossed into the latter half of the 20th century, it entered a period of unprecedented growth. The post-World War II economic boom brought an increased demand for consumer goods as GIs and their families settled back into life at home. The national mood had shifted from conservative wartime rationing to the expectation of a higher quality of life. Recognizing that heightened consumer demand would require increased capacity, Glatfelter embarked on a series of multi-million dollar expansions, putting quality paper products in the hands of millions. While focused on expansion, Philip Glatfelter II insisted on responsible growth, knowing that increased production would place a greater demand on the community's natural resources, to ensure those resources would remain abundant and well-managed for the benefit of future generations. Philip established the first sustainably managed tree farms in Pennsylvania and Maryland. He implemented a statewide reforestation program and served as president of the Pennsylvania Forestry Association. And he was appointed by the governor as chairman of the Keep PA Green Committee. Recognizing the company's environmental stewardship, United States President Dwight D. Eisenhower, on behalf of the American Forestry Association, honored Glatfelter with the Distinguished Service Award for the conservation of soil, water, forests, and wildlife. Throughout the 1950s, Philip became very active in the emerging green movement and worked extensively to carry the message to every corner of the state. In order to give this new obligation his full and undivided attention and help ensure its success, Philip transitioned the presidency of the paper company to his son, Philip III, just as Glatfelter celebrated its 90th anniversary. As Glatfelter's new president, Philip III set forth on an aggressive expansion that would span the 1950s and 60s. His first initiative was to double the company's production through a $12.5 million expansion program that included the installation of a paper machine called PM No. 7 and a facility to house the new line. With such forward momentum, the company was strongly positioned for further growth as the world entered a decade that would push the boundaries of innovation and reach new frontiers once thought unreachable.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
For Glatfelter, the 1960s brought a spirit of determined innovation and forward-thinking investment. At the company's 100th anniversary, Glatfelter embarked on yet another expansion, the largest and most ambitious project in company history, a $40 million multi-phased project. Phase one of the expansion added a massive paper machine to produce book publishing and commercial printing papers. The newly christened PM No. 8 turned its first reel of high-quality paper on April 4, 1965, recording one of the fastest startups in the industry. After a particularly bad drought in 1963, which impacted the community and the mill, and with the anticipated operational needs of PM 8, Glatfelter set out to provide the community and the expanded facilities with a more reliable supply of clean water. Embarking on a first-in-kind joint venture with the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, Phase 2 included the construction of the PH Glatfelter Dam along the Codorus Creek, just a few miles south of Spring Grove. The earthen dam gave birth to Lake Marburg, a 15-billion-gallon reservoir, and the centerpiece of a new 3,000-acre recreational area known as Codorus State Park. To this day, the park remains a major attraction for those who enjoy outdoor activities and a diverse wildlife habitat. At the dedication, Governor William Scranton praised Glatfelter's long-standing record of conservation, citing the wise use of lands and water to the ultimate benefit of all the people of the Commonwealth. In the third and final phase of the expansion, Glatfelter developed a cutting-edge secondary waste treatment facility. At the time, waste treatment only removed solids. No process existed for putting oxygen back into the water before returning it to the stream. To address this issue, Glatfelter scientists developed a patented technology to transfer oxygen back into the water. This provided a great benefit to the local wildlife and made Glatfelter one of the first mills in the nation with a primary and secondary waste treatment facility. The system proved so effective that Glatfelter encouraged other industries to adopt this environmentally friendly technology. During these years of rapid expansion, safety remained a high priority for the company. Glatfelter went to great lengths to ensure its commitment to safety was ingrained in the company culture, as well as the local community. As a result, Glatfelter consistently achieved one of the best safety records in the industry, recognized by the National Safety Council with multiple awards throughout the 1950s and 60s. Glatfelter even shared this message of safety with the company's neighbors, launching an annual safety night open to the entire community. The event became so popular that it was later expanded to an annual Community Safety Week, filled with educational events and entertainment paid for by the company. For Glatfelter, the 1960s were a time of great growth and investment in the company, the community, and the environment. Many of these accomplishments were built on the foundation laid by Philip II. Though he was no longer serving as president, Philip II remained a vital part of the community and the green movement in Pennsylvania. But sadly, Glatfelter would say goodbye to this respected leader and friend after having served his country, his community, and his paper company for nearly 60 years. Philip Glatfelter II passed away at the age of 81. With the arrival of the 1970s, Glatfelter was well-positioned for a long, profitable future. Unfortunately, the company would first have to navigate through a flood of difficult challenges. The first challenge came in the spiraling form of Hurricane Agnes, which slammed into Pennsylvania, causing more damage and financial loss to the company than any other single event. As the storm raged, an unrelenting wall of water, debris, and mud tore through the mill. When the rain subsided, Spring Grove was left under 5 feet of water, and damage to the mill was extensive. But the spirit and determination of Glatfelter people would not be dampened. Hundreds of employees worked heroically to return the facility to normal operation. In an issue of the Barker, Philip III praised his employees, stating, "The glue that effectively holds all of this together is the human element. It's the human element that has lifted us above the toughest situations." With the fury of Agnes still fresh in memory, Glatfelter would confront an entirely different storm, one that spanned the globe. As the recession of 1973 made landfall, with it came higher oil and gas prices, increased international competition, and a crippling stock market crash. Fortunately for Glatfelter, the forward-looking investments and continuous improvement projects of the last two decades had strengthened the company's operations and financial position. As a result, Glatfelter not only weathered the storm, but returned increased dividends to shareholders for years thereafter. After 25 years of distinguished service, Philip was ready to transition leadership of his company. But before stepping down, he made one final contribution to expand Glatfelter's reach into new markets. Philip III successfully orchestrated Glatfelter's first acquisition, the Bergstrom Paper Company, a leading producer of recycled printing and writing papers with facilities in Neenah, Wisconsin, and West Carrollton, Ohio. In his final address to employees, Philip left them with these encouraging words.
"We believe growing better is as important as growing bigger. Over the years, we've grown better by making an unbending commitment to better products and better customer service. We've grown better by making quality control, safety, and good housekeeping ways of life. We've grown better by practicing advanced forestry techniques and by assisting private landowners to do the same. We've grown better by getting involved early in pollution control and by setting the pace instead of following it. Today, the Glatfelter Company has grown into one of the most modern, well-managed paper companies in the industry. Through our commitment to growing better, we are also growing bigger."
It was a time of great change and ambitious investment. For the first time in over 115 years, a Glatfelter would no longer lead the company. As fate would have it, the new president had been raised with deep ties to the company. As a young teenager, Tom Norris worked part-time at Glatfelter's Spring Grove Mill, where he earned one of the company's first college scholarships. Upon graduation from Gettysburg College, Tom returned to his roots at Glatfelter, where he earned leadership positions in data processing and customer service, and was eventually promoted to vice president of operations. All totaled, Tom served 22 years before assuming the role of president in 1980. Just as the company had once invested in Tom's future, Tom would ensure sustainable growth for Glatfelter by leading the company through several historic achievements. Leveraging the company's extended track record of success, Tom took the company public, listing Glatfelter on the American Stock Exchange in 1983. The stock exchange expanded the company's access to financial resources and provided investors an opportunity to own a share of Glatfelter. Tom's growth plans also included the acquisition of the Acosta Paper Mill in North Carolina, a move that opened the doors to new markets in lightweight papers and ultimately doubled the size of the company. During his tenure, Tom Norris successfully led the company to achieving record sales of nearly $600 million annually. He had proven that Glatfelter could be led by someone outside the family, that the company could grow in success while sharing the benefits with employees, investors, and the community. The latter half of the 20th century was a time of unprecedented change. For Glatfelter and the world at large, these decades brought tremendous challenges. But under the leadership of Philip III and Tom Norris, and through the resilience of Glatfelter people, the company successfully turned these challenges into tremendous opportunities. This drive and determination kept Glatfelter in front of emerging trends and positioned the company for continued growth. With a new millennium up ahead, Glatfelter was proven fit for the future, a company that would never stand still. Every generation is faced with change and all of the challenges that come with it. You can sit still and watch it pass you by, or you can embrace it, get in front of it, and thrive. As Glatfelter prepared to enter the 21st century, the once vibrant U.S. paper industry was on the wane. Similar to steel, chemicals, and textiles, the paper industry was on the verge of deep secular change. The signs were clear. Paper-making capacity began to outstrip demand. Escalating costs collided with declining paper prices, and global competition began to impact U.S. markets. For the first time in history, paper mills in North America began closing large-scale operations. It was clear to George Glatfelter that in order to survive, the paper company would need a new kind of approach, a transformation that would take the company beyond paper. Succeeding Tom Norris as president and CEO, George immediately got to work redefining Glatfelter's business model to meet declining customer demand and rising costs. George challenged his team to aggressively embrace change and to share his commitment to change anything and everything that no longer created value for the business, to become a global leader and to thrive, not just survive. George Glatfelter's initiative would require a series of strategic acquisitions. First was the purchase of Scholler & Hirsch, a global leader in nonwoven filtration papers. With this investment, Glatfelter expanded its portfolio to produce teabag filtration papers, as well as overlay papers for laminate flooring and countertops. With facilities in Germany, France, and the Philippines, this acquisition opened doors to new growth markets in Europe and Asia and provided Glatfelter with access to state-of-the-art inclined wire technology. George continued to aggressively expand the company's portfolio into global niche markets with acquisitions in the United Kingdom, East Germany, and Canada. These acquisitions propelled the company into fiber-based absorbent materials and established Glatfelter as the world's largest manufacturer of air-laid products. They also provided additional capacity to support the growing coffee and teabag markets and expanded the company's production into metallized papers. Investments in growth were not limited to Europe. To secure Glatfelter's position as a leading producer of printing and writing papers in North America, the company acquired two operations in Ohio. This acquisition positioned Glatfelter as one of the largest producers of carbonless papers and provided additional capacity to expand the company into specialty niche markets throughout the U.S. and Canada. George Glatfelter's vision to transform the company was proving successful. By 2010, despite declining consumer demand in the U.S. and a crippling global recession, company sales had grown from just over $500 million in 1997 to $1.5 billion. Glatfelter was successfully reinventing itself and proving that it was truly a sustainable company. George had fulfilled his promise to the company and its investors. The company was now positioned to forge ahead well into the 21st century. With this, George decided the company was ready for a new generation of leadership, Like his grandfather, Philip II, George believed that a productive enterprise must be constantly alive to the process of change. After serving as president and CEO for 12 years and dedicating a total of 33 years to his company, George transitioned leadership to Dante Perini, an individual with a will and determination rarely found outside the Glatfelter family. Dante understood the culture and shared the same core values with a sense of urgency to continually move forward. As chief operating officer, Dante worked side by side with George for many years, helping to implement the company's global growth strategy. Together, George and Dante achieved an impressive track record of new product development, driving 50% of company sales from products less than 5 years old. Dante was a battle-tested leader who helped George Glatfelter navigate one of the toughest decades in the paper industry. As CEO, Dante wasted little time at expanding the company's global footprint. His first acquisition, a facility in Dresden, Germany, expanded Glatfelter's nonwovens portfolio into the growing wall covering market. Under his leadership, Glatfelter continues to evaluate global growth opportunities in support of its vision. Today, Glatfelter is an innovative supplier of specialty papers and highly engineered fiber-based materials, the global supplier of choice to major multinational customers with products marketed in over 100 countries. Across the company's three business units, Glatfelter holds leading positions in every major market it serves. Around the world, every day, Glatfelter people are working to enrich your lives. Glatfelter is with you in the morning as you brew that perfect cup of coffee or tea. In fact, 2 out of every 3 tea bags in the world are made from Glatfelter paper. And Glatfelter is there at the end of the day when you curl up to read a good book or relax with a cold beverage in hand. Glatfelter quality is in your greeting cards when you care to send the very best, and in your bank checks and legal documents, protecting your identity and giving you peace of mind. Glatfelter is putting the improvement in home improvement, making your floors and countertops scratch resistant and easier to clean. We even make wallpapers easier to hang and remove. Glatfelter innovation helps keep your life more active with thinner, more discreet nonwoven products for feminine hygiene and adult incontinence. Glatfelter's research and development is hard at work, delivering comfort and safety for you and your loved ones. Behind all these innovations are the scientists and engineers of Glatfelter's new product development teams, who help our customers bring exciting, life-enhancing new products to market. Through all the growth and evolution, Glatfelter has never lost its focus on safety. Since its earliest days, the company has remained committed to improving and maintaining a safe work environment, injury-free every day. Like a bedrock, Glatfelter's core values also remain unchanged: integrity, mutual respect, financial discipline, customer focus, environmental responsibility, and social responsibility. These core values are at the center of Glatfelter's culture and a key to our sustainability. They reside in the hearts and minds of all Glatfelter people, people that are not defined by any industry, but rather one bold and singular vision: to become the global supplier of choice in specialty papers and fiber-based engineered materials. For employees, customers, shareholders, and local communities, the future holds great opportunity and promise as Glatfelter continues its journey beyond paper. It's a journey of transformation that began over 150 years ago and continues today through the drive and determination of thousands around the world.
Спасибо из России. Мы стремимся к процветанию.
Thank you, Glatfelter, from the UK.
我们在中国，感谢您的支持。
让我们共同期待更美好的未来。
Ein Geschirr aus Falkenhagen, Deutschland.
Danke aus Gernsbach, Deutschland.
Hallo, viele Grüße und vielen Dank aus Deutschland. Tschüss.
Mula dito sa Pilipinas, hamat namin ang maginhawa inaharap.
La France vous remercie.
Nous souhaitons au groupe un avenir prospère.
Merci, yes, no, Canada.
We thank you from the United States.
A On behalf of all Glatfelter people worldwide, we thank you.